Hello, my name's Matt Young. I'm a Principal Solutions Architect here at ScaleFlux. Today, I'm going to take you through what is computational storage and how it can help your business. A little about myself. I was lucky enough to join the industry back in the 1990s. I've had the privilege of working with some really great large companies such as Data General and Microsoft, and I've also had some fun with some startups, most notably Fusion.io. I was very excited to be asked to join the ScaleFlux team back in December of last year, and today I'm going to take you through what is computational storage and how you might take advantage of it. So, computational storage, it's not a new idea particularly. It's new methodology, but we're all familiar with the idea of graphic processing units or GPUs from NVIDIA, AMD and others that have the capability of being able to perform some very specialist mathematics that relieves the pressure from the CPU from doing those functions. And sometimes they do it even better than the CPU can do, which gains even more power from that compute resource. In a similar way, we have the idea of smart NICs or DPUs. These again are network interface cards with an amount of compute on board that can do things like compression, decompression, encryption, and many other things at wire speed. So that leaves us with computational storage. Well, computational storage, very simply, is the idea of a storage device that has an element of compute on to perform a specialist function. These can come in many different shapes and sizes. We have NAND-based SSDs. We have some devices on the memory bus with DRAM. They may have FPGAs or ASICs, but their basic role remains the same, is we use the right compute type of resource as close to data as possible so that we can relieve pressure on the CPU and get more work done. So let's look at the ScaleFlux approach. We take our own SSD design that's designed to be as physically performant as any Samsung, Intel, or Micron device, and then we add our own custom silicon to give it some additional function that enables it to perform with better performance, better capacity utilization, and more endurance. Now, there's a couple of ways you could do this. Using FPGAs are slightly easier to design, but they consume host resources and can be more complex in other ways, and they're not quite as fast as an ASIC. Designing and delivering an ASIC is, from an engineering point, extremely tricky and very expensive if you get it wrong. ScaleFlux managed to deliver this with their first ever silicon design, and that's what sits at the heart of the CSD3000. This ASIC allows us to transparently compress and decompress data before writing to the NAND. Well, what does this deliver? Very simply, if you write less bits to the NAND, you have an increase in performance from an IOPS or bandwidth perspective from the host, and you also have the ability to run the device to a far higher capacity utilization before you see any abnormal performance side effects. And again, if you're writing less data, it means that your endurance and your reliability is greatly increased. So looking at the design ahead of you, you can see that we're a PCIe Gen 4 x16 interface. We then have, as I mentioned, our own custom ASIC on board that is then backed up by industry-leading NAND to persist and store the data. When we bring this all together, even with a modest amount of data compression, this allows you to get industry-leading performance both in IOPS and in bandwidth. It allows you to utilize your device well above 85-90%. In some cases, it also allows you to expand the namespace, so you may see double the capacity or even triple the capacity that you can use on the device. And then finally, because we're writing less data to the NAND, this allows us to go from a 5 drive write per day device to a 9 plus drive write per day device. Okay, so we've talked about the hype around computational storage, what it is, what it might be, what it currently is. I want to take a little bit of time now to deep dive on the ScaleFlux approach and run you through what a CSD3000 is and how it's made up. And to do that, I'm going to use my digital whiteboard. So how does ScaleFlux approach designing a computational storage device? Well, first off is we need to build an SSD that is physically the equal of any of the other enterprise class SSDs. And on board, we have some NAND. We use 16 channels to access that NAND, which is common in design practice for other enterprise class SSDs. We choose a U2 form factor. This is one of the most common form factors for SSDs, and as we move forward into generation 5 in the enterprise servers, we'll do other form factors such as E1S, E2, E3, etc. What else do we have on board? Well, we need a portion of DRAM. And the DRAM does a few things. It acts as an area and buffer to LAN data before we commit it to the NAND channels, and it allows us to manage our flash to translation layer. And at the same time, we do a few other functions with our DRAM as well. The next set, and this is the heart of our system and something that makes us a little different, is our SoC, also known as an ASIC. Now, this is custom designed by ScaleFlux, and inside it has a number of ARM cores. And what do those ARM cores do? Well, the first function that we implemented in computational storage was an inline transparent compression and decompression. Comp and decomp. So what's the other side of this? Well, to get data into the device, we are a PCIe Gen 4 interface. It does mean we'll work on older Gen 3 servers, but you're not going to quite see the performance that you would from a Gen 4 bus. So as we write data, it comes from the host into the DRAM, flows through our SoC, gets compressed, and then gets written to the NAND device where it's persisted. For data coming out, very similar, we read from those NAND channels, it gets hydrated or decompressed as it comes out the device and then to the host. So you can see from here that compression is always on. There's different ways you can use it, either having a regular size namespace, or you can do something called expanded namespace. And we're going to come on to the details of that a little later on. So, where can we use these wonderful ScaleFlux devices? Let's give ourselves a little space. We've seen customers use it on large data sets, particularly focused around machine learning and artificial intelligence. We have customers using it today in databases, both traditional structured databases and unstructured databases, such as NoSQL. We also see customers using it for streaming data. These streams might be IoT data coming in from sensors, or they could be examples of market data where we see financial institutions very interested in being able to take that high-speed network packets and being able to manipulate those and store them and then calculate risk upon them very quickly. ScaleFlux hasn't worked out every use case. We have customers that come to us almost on a daily basis with, could your device help us with this problem? And that's one of the things that we enjoy about the job, is we're helping customers work out new ways of using these devices to make their workloads that much more efficient and that much faster. Who knows? Maybe the next sci-fi motion blockbuster might be even filmed and shot and stored on ScaleFlux devices. We certainly are having those conversations today. So far it sounds pretty straightforward and pretty simple. And in essence, the idea is that simple. The benefit you get from compressing data on the storage device as opposed to elsewhere in the CPU or only on the network allows you to gain additional performance from your application. Now, this can have many side effects. This could be increased license efficiency if you're paying for a paid application such as SQL Server or Oracle. It could be that you're particularly sensitive to rack power, thermal, or other considerations from a sustainability perspective. But the point is, by using computational storage, especially with one with compression built into the storage device itself, it allows you to be more efficient on many, many levels. So how can I take advantage of this today? And what's in it for me? Well, the first thing you should look at is your application performance bound? Are you looking at system resource constraints, either in DRAM, CPU, or you're just that your storage device or storage array can't keep up? That's the first indication that this could be a great fit. The next one is your data set compressible? Now, to be fair, most people don't know whether their data is compressible or not. And some people have been led to believe that their data is completely incompressible. That can happen, but it's extremely rare. By working with ScaleFlux, we can provide you a tool that allows you to assess the compressibility of your data set, of the applications that you care about, and it will very quickly give you an indication of the degree of benefit value that you're going to see by deploying CSD 3000s in your architecture. The other thing is that our device right now is a U2 form factor device. That means you need a server with a U2 backplane, and ideally it should be Gen 4 PCIe. They do work in the earlier Gen 3, but you're going to live at performance. And the whole point of using a computational storage device is to gain that performance, capacity increase, and endurance. So in today's presentation, I've kept it deliberately high level and very simple to cover the basics. In the coming weeks, I'm going to take a little bit more time and go in depth around how the performance gains are realized, how you can get that capacity utilization up to a very high level, or even extend your capacity namespace by 2 or 3 times. And then also I'm going to follow up with how we get the endurance benefits, and then wrap it all up with how we overall operationalize these sorts of devices in our application infrastructure. But if anything I've said today piques your interest, and you have an application problem, maybe it's related to performance, then we'd love to hear from you here at ScaleFlux. You can reach out to us at the link below, and myself and the rest of the ScaleFlux team look forward to helping you unlock the power of computational storage and really make those applications fly. Thanks very much. So thanks for everybody joining today's session. We've already having some great questions coming up in the feed. So I'm going to take a couple of those straight off the gate. And the first one, do you require special drivers? No, this is a plug and play U2 PCIe Gen 4 NVMe device. So any server that has a U2 slot for NVMe, we will plug in and work with. We use, like every other body in the industry, the NVMe command line set. We have a plugin, just like every other vendor, that allows you to see some additional reporting. So to recap that off, is that we don't require any special drivers. We're a plug and play U2 NVMe device. Another question that's coming in, can we talk a little bit about the increased utilization? Well, this has two main approaches. We're gonna talk about the simple one. Let's say you buy a 7.68 terabyte device and use it with the namespace it comes to. Because the compression is always on, there's no way of turning it off, even with data streams that are thought to be relatively uncompressible, there's still a more small amount of compressibility, and even if it's a few percentage points, that does give you endurance and other increases in performance. So the increased utilization is very straightforward. With most devices, people short or limit the amount of capacity used, so somewhere between 75 or 80%. Because what happens beyond those cases, beyond those utilization rates, is that the device can then suddenly have abnormal performance, where the performance or the read and write characteristic changes depending on how much data is being stored on the device. Because we're compressing our data, whilst the device may appear to be 80% full, actually the reality under the covers in the NAND is much less. So you can still use all of that 7.68 terabytes right up to the limit and not see any write cliff or any abnormal performance behavior as you would on another device. Now the next question that comes to us is, how do I use the expanded namespace, the x2 or x3 capability? We're going to do a whole video on that because there is a little bit of operational detail that is worth diving into. But in very simple terms today, you would receive the device and you have already looked at your data. You've figured out that you have a compression ratio of say 3 or 4 to 1. How do you know that? Well, we actually have a tool that you can run on your file system, on your application data, so that you can determine that up front. Once you have the output from that tool, you can then take the device and delete the namespace that it comes with, and then create a larger namespace. So let's just use simple numbers for the minute. Let's say it's a 4 terabyte device and you want to create an 8 terabyte namespace. You would put that command in through the NVMe CLI, and then you would have this 8 terabyte namespace. You would start writing data to that point, and your file system would see that it has 8 terabytes to write to. You do have to keep an eye on not just the file system utilization, but the physical device utilization as well. That means that if you start writing data that maybe has a different compression ratio, less, or maybe incompressible data, then you might have a little bit of difference between those two pieces which you need to manage. But to actually get going with expanded namespace, very straightforward, very easy. Delete the old one, create the new one, and start writing data.